Thank you for joining us today at New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County Chapter of the National Organization for Women. My name is Rebecca Lubetkin, and I, along with the entire production crew, am a member of this chapter of NOW. And we're all volunteers. We all have day jobs of one sort or another. We've been at this for a long time. We're in our 21st year, and this is our 252nd show. All of our shows are archived in the Sophia Smith Collection at Smith College and are also available on YouTube at www.youtube.com/McNowNJ. McNow is not McDonald's, it's Morris County Now, NJ, New Jersey. Today's show, Project Stay Gold, will introduce a pioneering student-run high school club which aims to combat human trafficking. We have with us Sharon Thomas on my far right, the faculty advisor, and two students, Kylie Ackerson and Sydney Blanchard, in that order, all from Jefferson Township High School here in New Jersey. Sharon Thomas has been an eighth grade language arts teacher at Jefferson Township Middle School for 14 years. She has been a part of Project Stay Gold from the very beginning, organizing, planning, and running the logistics for their organization. Kylie Ackerson and Sydney Blanchard are juniors. Now I find out you're sophomores. Really, really seem to be older than you are and much more mature. Sophomores at Jefferson Township High School, and I welcome you all and thank you for being with us.
This is
a fascination for us because it's the first that we know of a high school club devoted to the eradicating of human trafficking. In fact, where you live, which is a very rural area, it would be a surprise to most of us to know that there is any issue of human trafficking in that area. So we're going to hear about all of that, but I want to start by asking you, and anyone can just jump in, what is Project Stay Gold?
All right, I'll start. Project Stay Gold is a student-led movement. Our goal is to abolish modern-day slavery in the world. We do start at a local level, but through speeches and education, we really can make an impact to spread the word.
And So Sydney, do you want to talk a little bit about how in eighth grade we started it and then moved it up to the high school?
Oh, it started in eighth grade?
It did start
in eighth grade. In the English curriculum, there is a book, The Outsiders, by S.E. Hinton.
Oh, you read The Outsiders?
Yes. Uh-huh. And in the book, there's a quote that says, "Stay gold, pony boy, stay gold," and meaning stay innocent, pony boy. And that's where the name of our organization comes from, Project Stay Gold. And it started with
It's your own name. It's not a name of a national movement or it's Jefferson.
Yeah, we actually coined it and then created a nonprofit organization around it. So when you say pioneers, we are the first.
Yeah.
So it started with our eighth graders and then our eighth graders wonderfully graduated to the high school, and then the program followed them all the way through the high school.
Did it stay in the eighth grade as well?
It did.
Yes.
So it kind of connects the high school and the middle school in that way. Mm-hmm. You meet together.
Yes, we do. Throughout the year, we have different times where the middle school will be our focus, and then the high schoolers come down to the middle school to teach some lessons.
Oh, really?
And then the eighth graders take what they've learned, and they teach the sixth and the seventh graders. And then our Project Stakeholders in the high school meet with their other advisory classes, like a homeroom class, like once or twice a year, and they teach these freshmen, sophomores, and juniors. So it's a whole school movement.
Wow. Well, going back to the sixth and seventh graders, have you had any feedback about how that's not appropriate and you really shouldn't be dealing with them?
We've had a few parents come back and forth, but then we really noticed that it's impacting our students. And we have wristbands that we've made for the club, and we've seen students like, oh, I got a Project Stay Gold bracelet, and yeah, we give out shirts and stuff, and it's a good thing for our school and community.
And the sixth and seventh graders, when they get Project Stay Gold presented to them by the eighth graders, they're always so excited to join projects to go in eighth grade. I know that's how I was when I was in sixth grade.
They couldn't wait to be
Was
up
it
there
hard for them to explain to you what it was about, though?
No, I don't believe so.
No, and eventually we were in eighth grade, because this began when we were in sixth grade. So eventually when we were in eighth grade, we were able to teach the sixth and seventh graders, and it was good. We were confident about it, and they were very comfortable with the issue.
Well, and I think that's part of that is it was intentional. On a sixth grade level, we don't focus on the sex trafficking.
Yes.
We focus on forced labor, making someone do something they don't want to do. Hair braiding, working in salons, working in household cleaning and things like that. And as the kids get older, we then change the topics to more age-appropriate
mm-hmm.
topics.
But it's all trafficking.
Oh, it's all yes. it's all trafficking, but age-specific.
Yes.
So we've tried to kind of...
And even and men are trafficked as well.
Yes,
yes, boys and girls. Even some of the boys brought into the discussion child soldiers. Because we were really
yes.
focusing on things that were happening in the United States, and the young men were the ones who widened our focus.
And in reality, it's happening all over the world, and it's happening to all different kinds of people, and it's happening in our backyards today. And a lot of people don't realize that.
Is there a sense that people have that this is kind of brought in by immigrants, not really our people, so to speak?
We do cover that in our speeches and stuff. There is like a large percentage of it is from like the women and men in other countries are offered a better life here in the States, where it could just be a pimp offering them a terrible, terrible lifestyle in the United States under these very poor sex trafficking or labor conditions.
However, we also go to the fact that it's not only in other countries.
Yes.
Right.
With the focus of the Super Bowl, we had a very, very busy year last year.
Yes. With our Not on Our Turf campaign, which focuses on being against human trafficking during the Super Bowl, because that tends to be a very large, it's very active during the Super Bowl, and that it could happen to anyone.
Tell us what you mean by very active during the Super Bowl. Are you referring to the fact that you're in New Jersey and the Super Bowl was in New Jersey?
We focus on that as well.
Yeah.
Statistics do say that in most major cities that it brings in the most sex traffickers. And then being in New York City area, the metropolitan area, there we focused on how the population percentage is much more severe here.
So we came up with a plan. We knew that the Super Bowl was coming to New Jersey, and we had been in an organization for about 2 years. So we spent a year planning and saying, what do we want to do to impact sex trafficking at the Super Bowl? And what we decided to do was call what we called summits. And we held two summits, and between both summits we had about 50 different high schools.
What's a summit?
A summit was a group of schools coming together to learn about a topic. Our topic was human trafficking, and then making a plan to do something about it. So the morning was education, our kids getting up, speaking, showing some videos, giving the background. In the afternoon, we made small breakout sessions where the schools were able to go back into classrooms. We held them at two different colleges. And they were able to make a plan, what were they going to do to combat human trafficking. So we saw great results from that. We touched about 40 different high schools in the area, in New Jersey and New York City. And it was amazing. From that, we have three new clubs started in other schools.
Oh, you have spread your...
Yes.
Did they call it Stay Gold, too?
Two do, one does not. They came up with their own name.
Uh-huh. And we are perfectly okay with that, yeah. as long as you're sticking true to your...
And that was all from these summit meetings that you had at the colleges.
Yeah.
Did you get out of school for that, or was that an after-school
meeting? Yes, we did. But one thing I want to say about the summits is that I love these summits. I think it is truly amazing the impact that we make. And the kids there, they're so insightful, too, and they are active in what we do. They ask questions. They want to know about this, and I think that is really amazing.
So did you guys go to the both different summits?
We did.
So can you talk a little bit about the New Jersey kids and then the New York kids, because it was two totally different backgrounds?
Mm-hmm. In New Jersey, we went to a suburban area, and the kids were not, like, they were interested in it, and they were from different schools, from different areas, but they just didn't seem all about it, and it was tough for us. They weren't very interactive, and
it was a large crowd, too.
It was, and I think they seemed uncomfortable talking about the issue with strangers.
You have a lot of kids from each high school? They were with people they knew, right?
Right, yes. But I think that when we went to our breakout sessions, which is where we go, like, the students go with groups of kids, we separate the large crowd. And I think that's when it really got personal, and that they got more active in the discussion, I believe.
Did you mix up kids from different schools for that, or could they go with people from their own school?
Yeah, we divided by classroom, by the different schools.
And what grade level were they, the kids who came?
They were high school students as well. I think we had college students as well.
Oh.
So what we found was in New Jersey, it was more of an education. When we presented them a plan to go out and do this, they said, okay, they have lots of different human rights organizations, and they'd use human trafficking as their topic of the year, which was great. But when we did it in New York,
New
York City. We went into, now I'm going to forget, what was an academy in New York City.
Queens.
Yeah, they had 250 kids show up, and they really were interested, and they set out a great plan. And then they sent us back things. They sent us back commercials that they made.
Really?
They sent back press releases and articles that they read. They just took it and ran. So that was, it was
very
amazing
gratifying
to watch.
Yeah. To do something like that and get all that feedback.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And to see the movement spread.
Yeah.
You know, we were able to, we talk about, you know, lighting a match and watching the flame go. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what's the secret of that success? Do you think it's that it's students talking to students?
I believe that's what it is. I think that because we are students, and that because we're not teachers talking to you,
right.
We're not teachers at an assembly, that it doesn't seem that, like, there's a connection. It's relatable. And I think that us being students plays a large part in it.
Right, the issue that we talk about, the average age group is our age. It's very easy to, it's like Sydney said, it's very relatable to discuss the issue, and it definitely makes an impact.
And it connects with how people become homeless, too, mm-hmm. And what happens when people become homeless.
Mm-hmm. That's actually how we started.
How did you start?
Mr. Papa and I were sitting down one day talking about kids.
He's another teacher?
He's another teacher. And it was he and I and Dr. Harris that kind of said, hey, we want to do something. We weren't quite sure what we were going to do. He was talking about the triangle trade in relation to slavery and then how it's still happening today. And we had a student who said, we need to do something about this. If this is still happening, we can do something about this. And her idea was to start a poster campaign. And we said, okay, if you want to start a poster campaign, okay, we'll start a poster campaign. But it came out of Mr. Papa and I talking about homeless kids and what happens to them when they're homeless. And that they do end up, that statistics show about 75% of them end up in a trafficking situation. So that...
At young ages, too.
At young mm-hmm. ages. And the stories that we've seen have been amazing. We were invited to the State House in Trenton to present. And the woman after us was a survivor. And we had just presented...
Who sponsored that?
It was actually the... Now I need to remember. It was the Department of Homeland Security.
One of the government agencies.
Yes, one of the government agencies. General Chiesa, the Attorney General, had just been sworn in that day. He spoke, and then our students spoke, and then a survivor spoke. And her story was that she was trafficked between the summer of her eighth grade year and her freshman. And Mr. Pop and I were looking at each other, and here we had eighth graders and freshmen.
Yes.
And it couldn't have spoke any clearer than that. These were kids helping other kids. And so it just blossomed from there. It's been an amazing journey, and we never know where it's going to go.
You say she's a survivor, so she was saved.
She was.
She,
mm-hmm.
she was saved from this. Mm-hmm. And she's, presumably okay now.
Yeah, now she's a mom of three kids, and she's written a book. And she's actually, at our summit, Skyped in with us, the wonders of the technology. She Skyped in and talked to both summits about her experiences.
So they had a survivor there, so to speak.
Right, mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. We couldn't have her physically there because she lives in North Carolina now. But
so when the students at your original meeting with Mr. Papa suggested that we got to do something about that, tell us the journey from that to actually getting a club.
Okay. Do you guys want to?
Because that doesn't automatically happen in most high schools or middle schools.
Yeah, Mr. Pop, Kate, our one student, Kate, she was moved by this, and that's how our name, Project Single, came about, and to preserve the innocence. Mr. Papa just seemed very also moved himself that our students, his own students, were just by a simple history lesson in class, they were moved to do this. I'm not familiar with the poster campaign.
Teacher?
He is, yes. At the time, he was an eighth grade history teacher, and now he teaches high school students.
So what ended up happening was Kate said, I would like to do a poster campaign. So she did a couple posters, and we had teachers come to us and say, human trafficking, slavery, what is that? And so from there, we started meeting with kids and saying, okay, we need to educate our own building. And that's really where it started, where we came up with a couple of lessons. At that time, it was only for eighth graders. It was eighth graders teaching eighth graders. Because we were...
Were you a club at that time?
No.
Just a group of kids
who wanted to do something. Mm-hmm. And that's where we left it, just because when you start to organize something, it kind of gets...
Right.
You get logistical problems. So we said, hey, there's a couple kids who want to stay after school, and this is what we're going to do. And so, and that's where it started, where we were educating eighth graders. And then we decided, you know what, we need to have a website. And we didn't want to be that regular website that just had a bunch of information on there. So we had someone who was really involved with videography. And he said, you know what? I can write a commercial. And so that's how it started.
But you still weren't a club.
No. We weren't officially a club until the next year. First September, we actually became a club. Per se. And by then, we had already started to get invitations to places to speak. We spoke at our own library, which was kind of funny because we were talking at our own library and we had police officers that came in because we invited them to come, and then someone else came. And they said that they had to do their homework before they came to our presentation, because it's not something people talk about, mm-hmm. especially in our town. So, and that's where it started.
So actually you were educating law enforcement too.
And it was, yes, we were. It was great.
One of our students, her father was the local policeman, and she always said how she went home and was telling about this wonderful idea that our students have come up with, and he was appalled that this exists in our
Did
own
you
town.
Have any denial? Board of Education or anybody else who said this really doesn't happen here, and so what are you stirring up?
Not necessarily.
No, we didn't have any deniers. We did have to explain our curriculum a couple times. People were worried about the age appropriateness of it, but once we were able to show that we were not talking about sex trafficking to sixth graders, that we were sensitive to their age and their ability to understand, then it was clear sailing from there.
So. You became a club, but without a paid advisor?
Yes. Is that?
Yeah. And it's an after-school club?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, we actually did it through the way we were able to. We're all about trying to do things that we want to do and then finding the way to get around the rules. Sometimes that's good. The way it works. We did it through a Pride in Education grant through the NJEA to hold different information nights, and that's how we funded it.
Within the community?
Yes. And then we used the school as a building, filled out all the paperwork, and that's my job. I fill out all the paperwork and things like that.
And you got approval without a problem?
Right.
Wow, that's really impressive. And I would say that your that straight line that you have from an idea to actually creating something is pretty unusual.
Yeah. Well, and it's not without its bumps and bruises, right?
Of course, we've
kind of stepped on a couple toes here and there. You know, we didn't fill out the right paperwork a couple times, or we were double booked, and we've made it work.
As Kylie was saying before, how Mr. Papa was seeing this concern among students, it's still there in Project Stay Gold today. I'm honestly amazed of how passionate people in Project Stay Gold are, and these are students volunteering their time to talk about this issue. And I think that's beautiful that kids our age are actually taking concern. And me and Kylie, we are very passionate about this issue. And I think it's great that kids today are still taking interest and are passionate about things and are feeling compassion for other people.
It's what we look for in developing an interest in a democratic society.
Mm-hmm. This is not something you can teach. We laugh on the teacher end sometimes because they're writing speeches and they're being persuasive in their arguments. Now, if I assign that as an assignment, forget about it. You know, it's pulling teeth. But ask them to present or to write or to come up with a PowerPoint for Project Segal for something they're passionate about.
Public speaking.
It's amazing. It comes naturally almost to talk about this
because you feel the passion.
Yes. I know I definitely do sometimes.
And how many members do you have in the club now?
We have over 100 students right now.
In the high school alone.
Right.
And the high school meets with the eighth graders as well.
Yep. Right?
So you want to talk a little bit about how that happens?
Sure. We our schools are connected. So at the end of the day, we all come together and we have...
You mean the buildings are mm-hmm. next
yes,
to
they're
okay.
connected. Uh-huh.
So our students meet together, and especially around when we were planning for the summits, we had the different age levels come together. So we had high school students and middle school students become partners for the breakout groups.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that was very helpful when with the younger students and for the older students. So we'd bring back different ideas because of course the older eighth grade students have the ideas of the sixth graders and seventh graders, and we all bring ideas together and it blossom from there.
Yes. And I think that Project Stigol, like with you'd think that like all the middle schoolers and the high schoolers, but it's such a friendly environment, and if anyone who has an idea, we want them to tell us about it. We want everyone to share their opinions and ideas. And it's, like I said, it's a very friendly environment, and it's really nice to see all these kids coming together.
You actually have, we have now different committees. And in front of you today, you have our social media committee. And they are the techies. So if anything about social media and Project Stay Gold, these ladies, they run everything. We've set up the accounts. The teachers have set up the accounts. For the most part, they even said some of them, but they run everything. They get it checked by us, but the kids do everything.
And this is without a budget? You have no budget?
Well, since the becoming a club and then getting some funding, we have done a couple of fundraisers, so we do have some money in our budget outside of school, not as a school organization, but as our nonprofit. We're working on it, but almost everything. The only thing that we've run into is transportation.
Yes.
And at first we were saying, okay, we'll go, and we were piling into different people's cars and meeting everyone there, and then that just wasn't feasible with 100 kids. Yet we had to take buses, so we had to raise money because we had to.
How did you raise money?
We've done a lot. I think our most successful. We had a bake sale at one of our home football games. Mm-hmm. Cindy and I, we like to do the graphic design, so we designed flyers, and we were playing Hoboken, New Jersey that night. And we had sent flyers to their high school to put around their school. And we raised a lot of money that night.
Yeah, the whole football game was themed with our Not on Our Turf campaign. And it was really nice, even for the other school, to learn about it, too, because we talked about it. There was kids who went on the field. Not on our turf,
so was it before the Super Bowl, then?
Yes, that was before the Super Bowl. Mm-hmm.
Not on our turf. We know that trafficking exists, and we don't want it here in New Jersey.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so that was the idea, because we didn't want the other school to think not on our turf, like we were insulting them. So for the weeks previous to the game, we sent them ribbons about not on our turf. We sent them announcements to make at their school, educating them about what Project Stay Gold was, what human trafficking was, and why this game was important. And then at the game, we sold wristbands and T-shirts and lots of baked goods.
Very creative, all of you. Something about either the subject or the environment at your high school really promotes that kind of creativity and resourcefulness.
Yes. It does. It brings our community together. We have a sense of community with Project Stay Gold.
And also in Project Stay Gold, we encourage kids with whatever you're talented at, whatever you love, use it to bring out the message of Project Stay Gold. And I think that encourages a lot of students and teaches everyone things.
One of the things that I was doing along with others, adults, before the Super Bowl, was we went to visit hotels in the area, and we informed the people who worked in the hotels about the kinds of things that would be happening and how to deal with it.
And a lot of them were acted as though they were completely unaware. Mm-hmm. And hopefully by giving them some information, they were able to keep some of that away. You know, you're talking about social media. Your website is fascinating. I hope we can put up the yes, it's up the website because you have a song now that's been written.
Yes, I think we have a couple now. One of our students is very talented musically, and
extremely
she writes beautiful music.
You have some videos there, and a lot of information. There are also other places where you're referring people to, like Polaris, yes. Mm-hmm. And that's a very good source of information. Let me ask you, because we're running out of time, mm-hmm. but I need to know what 27 stands for.
Well, we were hoping that my button would become obsolete.
I don't know if the audience can see that. That's a button.
It says 27 million. And when we started, one of our first things was to hand out these buttons because there were 27 million slaves in the world. And we hope that by starting our campaign, by starting Project Stay Gold, we would see a decrease in that number. Now, that was a very lofty goal. And now it's more of a rallying point because 5 years ago there were 27 million. And now estimates tell us, the UN tells us, there's 29.5 million.
29.5 million. And that covers all forms of trafficking.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Migrant labor kind of trafficking and
everything from child from child soldiers through, you know, hair braiding to sex trafficking.
To whatever they can. Are there boys in your room?
Yes.
Many.
Probably. Yeah.
And they have the same passion, or are they there to meet the girls?
No, they do. We all, no matter who you are, I think it's about, I'm an abolitionist and I'm a student, not whether I'm a female abolitionist. Mm-hmm. I'm a male abolitionist. I'm making a change. So,
One aspect where we're hoping to get into is talking about the boys and not partaking in in acts, because there has to be a consumer for this transaction to happen.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. We're just about out of time, and I want to thank you all.
Thank you so much for having us.
While we still have a moment, I wanted to say that there was a law passed in Sweden very recently in which they decriminalized prostitution, which is not exactly trafficking, but there's overlap. And they criminalized the partaking of prostitution, and they have reduced the incidence amazingly by just that one little change in the law. So thank you so much. We're pleased that this is going on. I wish it would go on in all parts of our county and our state and in the country. And I'm so glad that you're spreading the news so that other schools can pick up on it.
Thank you very much for having
us. Yes.
Yeah, thank you. We have a spa in our town in which was just broken up about 2 weeks ago. It was a front for human trafficking. And people say, you know, it can't happen here. It's just on the highway.